Good morning and welcome to the channel. This is part two of a series I'm doing on how to mud. So if you haven't seen the first part, go check that out if you're interested. This one will be the first coat of mud I'll be doing. We'll be using red mud. I've just dyed red in hopes to visualize the steps a little clearer and hopefully the camera picks up on it better than white mud going onto a white wall. It's all mixed up and ready to go. So let's jump in and start that first coat. Pro tip, put your mud in a bucket rather than try and use it straight out of the bag. Unless it already comes in a bucket, which they do have. There's the red mud. The plan is to do this alcove because I have an outside corner, inside corner, some small flats, and an off angle. But for my flat, I'll actually show you in the closet here because it's a bit of a longer run than these skinny ones here. So again, with the tapered edge of the drywall, it is a little easier to fill because it does make that valley for us to put mud in. You can use a hawk like this or a box. It really depends what you're comfortable with. I was trained with a hawk, so I just feel better with it. Although I know a lot of people who do use the box that you just hold. And I use a 4-inch trowel, scoop my mud on like so. And then this is the part where practice is the only thing that will make you better at it. I can tell you how to hold your knife or how to spread it on the wall, but you really have to get hands-on for that. This is how I hold it though. And then I spread it by applying a little more pressure to this corner of my knife. And I want to make sure it's pushed into that seam so it kind of keys and locks in as it dries. So I've laid the first coat of mud into that seam. Now I can embed my tape into it. And now that my tape is on, I'll start from the center and just press it lightly into it. And now that it's made contact with all the tape, I press more firmly, starting from the center again. Make sure it's nicely pressed into my seam. So now that I've embedded this tape with my 4-inch knife, I'm gonna go over it with, I think this is an 8-inch knife. Normally I use a 10-inch curve, but I can't find it, so we're gonna use this. Again, there's different ways you can go about mudding it, as long as you achieve the end goal. And what this coat does is fill in that valley that the tape is now sitting in. So you want to pull it fairly tight when you go over it. You don't want to create too much of a mound because sanding sucks and wet mud is easier to deal with than dry mud. I clean off my edges. I think some people call it the shoulder. Because if you don't do that, then your following coats of mud will build up on that little ridge on the edge and you'll end up with an edge that's really hard to sand. That's the first coat on the flats. Now we'll jump back over here and do the inside corners. The inside corners are pretty much the same like I explained on the drawing there. So I'll cut my tape to length. This is how I cut it. These vertical ones don't have to be as accurate because you want up off the floor a little bit and your baseboard will cover. So it's a good habit actually not to go down to the floor with those. Then you have a buildup of mud and your baseboard for your trim is messed up in those corners. Crease my tape. Stick it where it goes so I know and it's easy to remember. So I have all my tape pre-cut. And then I'll just crease them all, put them where I need them so they're within reach and I don't forget where they go. And now we'll start mudding it. So I'll do my inside corners first and I'll do my outside corners. You can tell that I actually don't have too many flats in this alcove. There's really only this one. And then these small ones. That's because I was able to stand these sheets up vertically and eliminate the horizontal seam that you see everywhere else. So again, the more seams you eliminate, the faster things go and the better finish you get. So it's the same method with the inside corners as the flats. We want to lay mud in first to embed our tape into. And again, I put the mud on my knife the same way. And I use the same motion, but I try and ride it against the inside corner wall. Because again, I want to make sure that the mud is actually fully coating that inside corner. That's what it looks like. Doesn't have to be too pretty. But the prettier it is, the easier it goes. And I just push my tape in again like that. I push it into the corner and then press it lightly, starting from the middle outwards. And then you go again a little firmer. And as I'm pressing, I'm squeezing out the excess mud behind the tape. I'm using this side of the knife here to push up against this part of the wall, like that. That ensures I'm getting right into the corner of the wall. So you squeeze out the excess. And then we're gonna coat one side of this tape, which is technically part of the second coat. I wish I had more hands, but I can't hold my hawk at the same time. But this is what it looks like. Just apply the mud. It doesn't have to look fancy at the beginning. But then with your last pass, you wanna try and do a long pull to make sure you don't have any swoop marks, which look like that. And again, I use that edge of the knife to go against this side of the wall to ensure that I do fill that corner in properly. And then I wipe off this edge again. And that's the first coat of mud slash half of the second coat. If you do see any globs, you can clean them up, but don't get too carried away with making it look perfect, because then your mud starts to dry and you start dragging little bits of dried mud around and it's just harder to pull. So know when to leave it alone. If you find resistance in using the mud and its pliability, then just don't touch it. Because again, mud is cheap, drywall is cheap, your time isn't, so be efficient with it. Don't try and go into that corner and make it look too nice. That's only the second coat. There'll be another coat to make it look nice. Now my three-way corner is a little more interesting. It's gonna be a lot harder to show as well, but same thing. Apply my mud, try and get it into that corner. Put the mud on. Run it up the wall. Again, I'm just pushing it into the corner using my knife, making sure it's all where it needs to be. Doesn't have to go to the bottom. And then once it's in the corner, go over it lightly. And now that I know the tape's not gonna go anywhere because I have it fully embedded, I'm gonna go over it again, a little more firm. Don't start at the top because you'll end up bringing the tape with you and ripping or tearing or making a ripple in it. So go a few feet away from it to begin. Go tight, riding this edge against this side of the wall. Pull it tight. And then again on this side, do the same thing. And then this is gonna be what's called a three-way corner. They're definitely a little tricky. So again, just take your time if you are learning or a beginner. So this corner is completely done. I have the one side mudded. Now I'm gonna do the opposite side of the wall, which will be this side of the wall, to do my second pass. on this tape I just laid. It's important you do the opposite side. So we have the two corners done, this one and this one. One side with part of the second coat done. Now we'll go ahead and do the third corner. Doing the exact same thing. Now I can embed my tape in the third and final corner. Just like that. I've pressed my tape in lightly. Now I'll go over again and make sure it's really seated into that corner. That's how much excess that has come out behind the tape. That's why it's important to make sure you squeeze it out. Not too hard though, because then the tape won't have anything to adhere to. And then for my three-way corner, I'll again remove that excess. That's what it should look like. So I've mudded this side of this wall, and I've mudded this side of this wall. That means I'll mud the ceiling on this side. Just like that. And I'll do this flat section here while this mud is still wet. And I do it just like I did the horizontal wall. And you always want your tape to overlap each other. At least half of the width of the tape. And because that's a tapered factory seam, I'll go over it with my wider knife. Clean off my edges. That's how you do the flats and inside corners. The straight corners and the three-way corners like that. So I'm gonna go ahead and do this one, and then we'll do the outside corners. So before we do the outside 90 degree corners, we're gonna do this off angle, which is a outside off angle. Right here, it turns into an inside off angle. And for that, we just use this flexible corner bead, which can flex to an inside or outside. It's the same steps to apply it as you would an outside corner. However, they do call it no coat, meaning, wow. Technically, that would mean you don't have to do any mud, but it says two coats of mud and you're good to go. I haven't used this product too much, but it's all kind of the same in theory. I'm gonna try and fill up this gap. There's a bit of a void here where the angles come to meet each other. And now I wanna apply mud to either side of that angle. A little more than one of these sides width, which is an inch and a half maybe. And really I use the same technique, same hand movement for this as I have with the flats and inside corners. Get some mud on my knife. Use that sideway motion to push it on. You really want to make sure this corner bead has full adhesion. Because there's gonna be a lot of movement at this intersection where the ceiling goes from angled to flat. That's why I put so many screws in it too. So I'm kind of defining my corner a little bit with the mud. Give you a closer look. Like that. I'll kind of go with the same application process as everything else I've done, that is, set it in place first, squeeze all the excess out, and then do a coat over top of it. So right now I'm just wiggling it on to get it seated. There's actually a factory defect right there slightly. Shouldn't influence me. And now that I've got it seated where I want, I think, and now I'll lightly go over it again with my knife. Again, by doing this, I can go back over it again and push it firmly into place. I just don't want it to wiggle around when I do try and push it firm. It's where I want it to be. And now what we have to do is make sure that this corner here is seated and pushed firmly to where it should be. I can either use my hands like this and rub it, but you might get a friction burn from that. So I just use my snips. You can buy specific rollers that are designed to fully seat that corner, but with my snips, I can just close them up and use the handle, this part and this part, and push it as long as I don't move it too much like this. So again, I'll start in the middle, and I'll just push that corner in. And ideally, you do get some squeeze out. Now that the inside corner is seated, I'm gonna go over it tightly with my 4-inch knife on here, staying off the corner a little bit. So a quick way to check to make sure that it's seated properly is to put your straight edge up against it like this, from this high point to here. And if you have light shining through the middle, that means you've created a valley which you can then fill. But if it rocks, that means it's sitting on a mound and you can't fill a mountain like that. So you just go along, check it like this. If you have light coming through, you're good to go. And with this product, it's designed to do your second coat right away. So I've upgraded my knife to a wider blade. This is a 5-inch opposed to a 4. And I'm gonna run it just like so. I'm not gonna go right to the peak of it. It says it on the box, it's just the required application that they suggest. Basically looks like this. Make sure you drop lots of mud on you, it's good for the skin. It's actually not, it dries it out. I'm still making sure that there's daylight coming in between my knife, because I can still wiggle that corner bead if there isn't. But after this dries, you're not gonna be able to correct it. So I put it on, pull it straight, do the other side right away too. It's crazy not to. Try not to get it on that outside corner. That's actually supposed to be painted right on. There we go. That's the angled outside corner done, first coat and second coat. Now it's time to do these outside corners, and that's the last piece to the puzzle. Just gonna do this flat here first. Like that. And then for my outside corner, it's the same as what I just did. We'll put mud on the corner using the same motion. I actually should do the other side first because I want to fill in this void, because this piece of drywall is recessed a little bit. Also want to push it into this crack. Just go up the wall. So you can tell that I like lather it on pretty good, and then I pull it straight afterwards. It just makes the corner bead go a little easier. And I like having full coverage on that corner, even though it is metal. Just helps protect against any dings or dents, impacts. Do this other side, which is a lot easier because I don't have to really fill anything. And then I've pre-cut my corner already. I just took an inch off the bottom because my ceilings are 8 feet high and my corner bead's 8 feet high, but I do want it sitting up off the ground a little bit. I put my factory end up first, just a good habit because our tin snips can make a mess of it sometimes. So this is my factory edge. You can see that this side of the metal is wider than this side. So I want my wider piece to cover up the butt end of the drywall. Like so. And it's basically the same as that offset angle. I seat it with my fingers, embed it into the mud, go over it lightly with my 4-inch knife. And now that I've gone over it lightly, I'll do the check again to make sure that the bead on the corner of it is a little high, so I have light coming through. And in this situation, there's none, so I can just wiggle the corner bead out a little bit until that light does shine through. Again, we do that because that valley where the light shines through is easier to fill than if it were to be rocking or no light to shine through. Because we want to make sure this paper is covered. You also notice when I'm going over it again to firmly set it in place, I'm not going right onto the corner. I'm actually going off just a hair so I can squeeze the mud that's on the paper out. And then using my 4-inch knife again, I'll do my second coat right away. And basically, I just want my 4-inch knife to ride on this bead here and against the wall here to fill in that valley. I'll clean up the edge again. And repeat for the other side. So that's how you do the outside corner. My next pass will be with a wider knife, probably the 5-inch, which will come from this point to the wall. So the last thing we have to do to complete our third coat is the screw heads. Pretty simple. You get mud in your knife just like every other time. And with the same hand motion, you do that. That's the first coat done, and I actually left a butt seam open that I haven't done yet over on another wall. So just for the sake of showing you how to do that as well with this colored mud, we'll do it real quick. The two things you'll notice with this butt joint are there's a bunch of screws in it, and that's just to help stitch it together. So if the stud behind it does move and twist and shrink, or the building shifts, hopefully it moves together and there's no crack. So filling it up with screws definitely helps with that. I've also back cut the edge on both sides. That allows my mud a place to go and key in and hold a bit better. And by eliminating that ridge, there's less mud buildup and I should hopefully have to mud slightly less. So same thing, just push it full of mud. Make sure there's mud behind your tape. Put the piece on. Push it in lightly first, starting from the middle. The Now for a butt joint, it's important you don't squeeze out too much mud because then you'll starve the tape from that adhesion and it won't stick. So you want to go firm but not as tight as you would the tapered joints. Ideally I'd use a 10 inch curve, but I don't know where that is. So this will work fine. If you don't have one of these and don't want to spend the $60 on one, you can use a flat trowel and just float it a bit and build up the mud. It's just a little trickier. And then I'll clean up these edges. And that's the first coat on the butt joint. So that does it for the first coat of mud. You can definitely see it a lot better with it colored a bit red, which helps. The second coat I'll do in blue or white probably, so you can see the definition between the two, and that'll be right after this. So I'll see you in probably 48 hours to do that second coat when this is dry.